Hi, my name is Carol Post. I'm the Chief Operations Officer here at New York Law School. On behalf of the Dean and the entire law school community, I'd like to welcome everyone here this afternoon, particularly welcome you having braved the yet again thunderstorms. Looked like it was clearing for a day or so, but not yet. So thank you for weathering the storm, literally. We're really proud to have this particular event here at New York Law School today. For New York Law School, in our more than 100-year history, we've really been known for fostering discussion and bringing thought leaders together around important issues. And there's probably no more important issue than the democratic process and providing tools and resources and the ability for citizens to engage in the democratic process. So we're very excited to be a part of that. We have also been instrumental in bringing different sectors together into discussion. In this case, the civic community, the business community, the legal community, and many others. So we welcome the many partners that are here participating on stage and with you in the audience as well. In my history, I've had the privilege to participate in all three of those sectors, the business sector, the civic sector, and now the legal sector. I'm formerly with the mayor's office, and in that time I had the pleasure of meeting Amy Locrest, who runs CFB. We participated in a leadership program ages ago, I think, feels like, but many years ago, and I'm really proud and delighted to see that the leadership lessons that we learned, she's really brought them to bear at the CFB and in many ways throughout the community. So, again, I'd like to welcome everyone here. We're very honored to have this important discussion and the unveiling of some new technology that will be made available here today. So with that, I'll turn it over to Amy for the rest of the program. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. Thank you, New York Law School, for hosting this beautiful space and letting us have our event here. I really want to thank everyone again for joining us here today. We're really excited to see so many people and to share this really, really exciting project that we are at the CFP are incredibly excited about. Joined by some women's camera. Thank you for coming. We've had, in developing this project, we've had some really, really great partners who have created and contributed their time, their resources, their creativity, and technical skills to this project. And you'll hear more about all of those contributions before we're done here today. And all of those people have our deepest appreciation for all the work that they've done on this project so far. We at the CFP are really very proud of the work that we've done in creating the New York City's Public Matching Funds Program. As you many of you know, the program is looked to as a model for both reformers on the state level and on the federal level, and we're very, very proud of the success we've had over the 25 years of that program. One of the main aspects of that program is to help New Yorkers become more involved in New York City elections. And we are trying to make New Yorkers have their voices heard. What we think you will see here today is another great step forward in making that happen, using design, technology, and connectivity to really make New Yorkers have their voices heard in the electoral process. This project has been a long-time vision of the chair of the Campaign Finance Board's Voter Assistance Advisory Committee, Art Chen. When he was appointed to the Campaign Finance Board 5 years ago, we had a long conversation about how technology could be better used to improve democracy. When he was appointed the chair of the Voter Assistance Committee in 2011, we talked about this specific project, and after a lot of hard work on his part, for which we are endlessly thankful, we have this demonstration for you today. So while it's a passion of his, we are very grateful to be the recipients of his efforts and all of his vision. And without any further ado, I'm going to introduce you to Art Chen, the chair of our Voter Assistance Advisory Committee.
Is this working? Yeah, it works well. Okay. Well, hi, everybody.
Hi.
Okay. thank you all for being here, especially on a day when I feel like there's some apropos analogies to the Truman Show. How many here have seen the Truman Show? Okay, so in the Truman Show, for those who haven't seen it, there's a character named Truman who lives in this perfect world that is manufactured entirely for his behalf. Although he doesn't understand that he lives inside of a physical bubble. And when he discovers it, he's trying to get out. Well, today, I feel like I'm really grateful for all of you for being here because we're a little bit like the Truman Show, but it's a wiener show. And instead of a wiener trying to get out, we're trying to get into his attention bubble. So it's really even more wonderful that you all are here. So thank you very much, and I promise that this will be the last lame joke that I tell. Anyway, I want to ask, when we started this, and just kind of some common sense questions, you know, we asked, you know, actually in the Arab Spring, we asked this question of why. Why is it that people in their everyday lives have access to powerful tools for communication? For finding out easily what their friends are doing, for connecting socially, for engaging in transactions, for being able to become members of different e-commerce sites. Amazon is a very powerful analogy of this. Why is this possible? And why is it that government, which is so vital to our sense of place and purpose, is at a distance from what we as consumers enjoy day to day? And so we ask, why not? Why not allow people the same conveniences that they enjoy in their private lives to become members, to be able to create their own user accounts, to be able to set their preferences and their notifications, to be able to discover and to shop, to select, to engage with others who look at the same thing? Why not? And what if we took a look at what was needed, and instead of letting the walls that divide us from our government prevent us from helping our government, what if we could actually get together some of the most talented and best people to begin to create a bridge between people and their government, where technology can provide the same convenience and power that we all enjoy in our day-to-day lives? What if? And so, as Amy mentioned, 18 months later, or 2 years later, whatever it is, it feels like a very, very long time, I'm not counting. Obviously, we're standing here today at a very important moment. Thank you. And one of the things that I want to say, first of all, is that it's very important that this event is for candidates. There are 30 council campaigns, 8 mayoral campaigns, 2 for president campaigns, 1 controller, and 1 public advocate who have signed up to participate in this event today and be part of this platform. And that's with about 4 days of notice. So I appreciate that, and I think for those of us who've been on the inside working on this, we understand that without candidates, there is no democratic process. And where we're starting off today is at a very fundamental point, a mission point of the Campaign Finance Board, which is to expand the power of small donors in the campaign finance system. That for too long, in so many places, in Albany and elsewhere in the country, we read about the extraordinary power that special interests have in advertising, in making their influence known in the halls of their government. Here in New York City, we have the privilege of working in a system where small donors can receive up to a 6-to-1 match on their contributions. And as a result, we have the ability to shift power to small donors on behalf of new candidates, allowing them to run. But they've been impediments. The rules are presented, are created as a way to make sure that public funds are spent in the most honest way possible. And that's created a lot of paperwork and a lot of challenges for candidates to navigate that. So we said, what can technology begin to change that? And so what I hope you come up with today is a beginning. It's a beginning of a process that begins with a candidate, goes through the contribution process. And we'll have a product that will be released in approximately 10 days that will hopefully will do this for you. And my colleague Michael Carlson will be coming up soon to talk to you about that. But ultimately, our vision is much bigger. Let me actually just go to the next slide. I just want to just kind of step back for a second. People in government. We've tried too long, I think, to kind of really be in a situation where people in government don't truly engage. But when I talk about the efforts that have been created between the private sector and the public sector, working in a true collaboration to bring something to reality that has never been done before. This is what I'm very proud of. I don't stand here today as somebody who's actually done the work. I basically ask some basic questions. Why not, and what if? And because of where we sit in time and in the state of technology, a lot of people support. And I'm not going to list every name here, but what you see are some of the top design firms, software development firms, social media marketing agencies, and others who have stepped forward to contribute thousands of hours and millions of dollars of their pro bono efforts to this very important cause. Alan, next. Where this is all going to lead is to a voter engagement tool that will help people discover who's on the ballot, to be able to do research on those candidates in the most level playing field possible, to be able to engage with those candidates in the social media, and to engage with your own social networks about those candidates, to be able to see who endorsed them, and then actually the most ultimate endorsement, which is to vote with your wallet. We envision voter registration as a customer account. It's a user account for democracy. How do you belong to democracy? You belong to democracy through your right to vote, which is in your voter registration card. We want to make that as easy as possible. I'm very pleased with our partnership with TurboVote to make it possible, to make it easier to manage voter registration. And we'll be working on more. So get information about candidates. Everybody says, now it's so interesting, when I talk to folks who are 60 and older, they say, oh, we don't need anything new. We have a newspaper, we have television, we have radio, we engage in political conversations. But for those who actually are in their 20s or 30s, and for myself, you know, kind of a relatively, you know, immature 50-year-old, we get much of our information from Facebook and Twitter. This should bring the same convenience to people. Make contributions via mobile. And Michael will walk through more of this today. And then to receive voting day information. When you buy something on Amazon, what do people say? Thank you. Thank you for buying. Here's when this is going to be shipped to you. After you receive it, what do you think of the seller? What do you think of the product? Would you care to rate it? There's an opportunity to use technology to provide the same kind of conversation around candidates that we enjoy in our consumer lives. So what next? So obviously, you know, we aim to show that if you can make it in New York, you can make it anywhere. I grew up in Ohio. And as a boy about the age of my two sons who are sitting back there, helped drill my parents on becoming a citizen, and preparing to vote. And around the same time, I realized that New York City was the greatest city in the world, and I made it part of my mission to be here. And so I am here today, kind of doing both. And it is true that in New York, if you do it here, you can do it anywhere. This is a model for what we think democracy could look like using technology. So I'm very pleased that I'd like to introduce Alan Holder, who is sitting behind the controls. Alan actually is the person who pulls the strings behind the project. He's our project manager, volunteering with us for the past 3 months. I want to point out the VoteSCO team. Raise your hands. This is a team of community hackers who I met at a hackathon when I tried to float this project to see if anybody would bite. And boy, did they. Not only did they step up to volunteer, they took in a germ of an idea and fleshed out something that became the model for what we have here today, what we'll show going forward. And they continue to provide help all on a pro bono basis. So thank you guys very much. But most of all, I want to make it very, very clear that it's a two-way street. It's not just the private sector with our talent and our capabilities. It requires a public sector counterpart. And I just want to say how grateful I am to Amy Lopress and the rest of the Campaign Finance Board who have every department in the agency has received this mission with open arms and embraced it and made it their own. From the audit staff, to technology, to campaigns, to candidate services, you all have been fantastic, and it's obviously going to happen without you. So thank you. And last, but certainly not least, my Voter Assistance Advisory Committee members. There are a couple here. If you're here, Jeff Merritt. Yeah. If you're here, raise your hands. Okay. And, yeah, so John Avalon is skulking in the back. Thank you, John. At times when my energy has flagged for this, these are folks who have prodded me to keep going. They've sometimes called me, sent me emails. Not quite threatening, but almost. So this is another reason why we're here today. So without further ado, I've spoken too long and thrown in one too many bad jokes. I'm going to introduce Michael Carlson, who has been the product manager for this project, and he's going to walk us through this technology.
Hello. Everybody hear me? All right. My name is Michael Carlson. I'm honored to be the product manager on this project. As you can see, that there are many, many people in that previous slide who have been involved in this process. And it's really been inspiring, and it's a great, great goal. So thank you for everyone for your efforts, and thank you for letting us be here and to show some technology. So today, we're going to talk about the candidate contribution tool. So the candidate contribution tool, what is it? It's kind of the first phase, right? It's the first phase of a number of products that we're rolling out to help with voter engagement, to make the democratic process a little bit more effective for voters, for campaign staff, and for candidates. So what physically is it? Physically, this is a moment of... it's still here, right, Schubert? It's still here. It's a mobile web application. So mobile web meaning that this is something from a mobile phone. You can access it on your smartphone so long as that smartphone has a modern web browser. So if you have an Android phone and you have an Android browser or a Chrome, or you have an iOS device with Safari, you can access this on the web. It's open to the web. But it's for your mobile device. But that makes me kind of the genius of what this thing is. But what is it actually, right? It's a candidate contribution tool. A candidate contribution tool is really three separate products. It's a credit card processor, so it's a means for candidates to process credit card transactions in order to get contributions. It's also a compliance engine, so it's got a lot of logic built in, you know, from some really, really sort of nitty-gritty conversations with our friends at the CFP to really learn how this stuff works. So it makes sure that compliance, that we capture as much of that compliance information that we need to so that those credit card transactions can get all the way through the process. And it's also kind of an assistant, a document assistant, in helping to catalog all the information that's required throughout this process. So some of it official, some of it unofficial, some of it quasi-official, but documentation in order to help get us through this process and get candidates to be able to start with the contributor at a party somewhere or out in the field and to be able to get a contribution and to get it all the way through the system as simply and as easily as possible. So without further ado, we'll start. So this page here is the landing page, right? It's the landing page for nycvotes.org on mobile. And this itself, you can see that there are three sections, three tabs there. The voter, the candidate, and the campaigner. So right now we're focused on the candidate and on campaign staff and on helping them get credit card contributions, but as Art sort of walked everyone through, the vision is to have this be a jumping off point for everyone to get involved in the electoral process. So we're going to go ahead and log in as a candidate. Alan, who is very thankfully doing the high-stress task of typing on an iPhone in front of a couple hundred people, thank you very much, Alan. He's going to be kind of impersonating a relationship that might exist between a candidate and a contributor who are working together in order to get a campaign contribution. So he's going to go ahead and log in. There we go. Okay. .com. Okay. So this first time that Alan is going to be logging in, we're going to assume that Alan has logged in before, right? So he's not going to sign up for anything. But the first time a candidate would sign in, they would step through a very simple process where they would receive an email confirmation. They would sign up for a password. They would comply with some legalese, and they would put in some financial information. I'm going to close out and come back.
Do you need a charger?
Okay, we're in. All right. Sorry for the hiccup. There we go. Technology maybe not can't solve all the problems all the time. Okay, so here we are. We're assuming that Alan, as a candidate, John Doe, who is with someone providing him a contribution, has gone ahead and logged in. He logs in and he's brought right to this flow, right? This contribution flow so that he can get the contribution as quickly as possible. It's a four-step process, but throughout that process there's a header up top which reminds the contributor who it is they're contributing to. Provides context throughout the process. So step one is to choose an amount. As you can see up on the screen, we have a couple predetermined amounts, but also the capability for someone to enter their own amount. So if they want to give $119, they can contribute $119. But let's just select something simple like $100. And you see immediately that this pane kind of is shown on the page. And this pane here is all about the campaign finance program and about public matching. And so this application is built in with all the kind of information that is required and logic in order to understand what the maximum possible effect that an individual's campaign contribution can have for a candidate. So if a candidate is enrolled in the campaign finance program, this is how much it could be worth to that contributor, to that campaign. Of course, there is another bit of logic in here, too. Not every candidate is enrolled in the campaign, so if they're not enrolled, then this pane would not show up. So So we're going to go ahead and jump to the next page. Employment. So employment is an important piece of compliance. You have to understand if someone is doing business with the city, and if so, how that affects their contributions. So we're going to go ahead and put in some information, things like who their employer is, their employer's address, their occupation, in order to make sure that all that information comes through on the back end in the same. So perhaps the most important piece on this page is the affirmation, whereby the contributor indicates whether or not they're doing business with the city, because that has real implications on how much they can contribute. So Susie Smith and Susie Smith Elevators does not do business with the city, so we're going to click the next button and head on to the next page. So now we're getting to personal information. This is where the flow kind of starts to look an awful lot like checking out at Amazon or one of these websites. Lots of information, first name, last name, pretty straightforward stuff, right? So our friends in the CFP are going to have the last name to do. So first name and last name, a whole bunch of other information, and our whole goal around this is to capture all of the information that's required, but only all of the information that's required for a compliant contribution. So we're trying to make it as simple as possible, but also as safe as possible for the candidate themselves. So there are a number of helper kind of functions throughout, one being here, used for billing address. You'll see a lot of these sort of different helper functions throughout the application. They're meant to, in order to streamline, but they're also meant to find specific information about contributions, because if the residential and billing addresses do not match up, it's actually something really important in the compliance world. But we're trying to keep those things from being exposed to contributors from a sort of usability standpoint, so it's easy as possible. But we're going to jump to the final page, which is billing of this four-part process. Billing information, also pretty straightforward, right? But on the back end, what we're doing is we're capturing a lot of specific information about address verification, zip code verification, lots of sort of really important things in order to ensure that the contributions themselves are compliant. And we're storing all of that information in files which the campaigns can have access to in order to go ahead and audit their contributions. So the whole goal is give them as much information as they possibly can use in order to make sure that this all comes through and they get those public match contributions. Perhaps the most important, at the end, an affirmation statement that they are getting this money of themselves and not from some other interest. So we're going to hit agree and step through and finalize our contribution. Great, and so the contribution has gone through successfully, no errors, and we've presented Susie Smith, who has donated to the campaign of John Doe, with a bunch of information, and she can even get an email receipt with all the information so that she knows exactly what happened, she has all that data. But this isn't just a sort of contribution engine, right? There are a number of other pieces of functionality, one of which is a contribution tracker. So we're going to go ahead and navigate over the contribution tracker, which, while pretty straightforward, is really intended for a simple purpose, to reference, right? So the candidates can reference all of the contributions that they have put through to the campaign finance board that are publicly available, just as a quick reference, as kind of a helper function, so that they can take a look and browse this information when they're out on the campaign. We have a bunch of other pieces of functionality which are over in our account section. The first and probably most important to a candidate is that they can invite other people to take campaign contributions for them, their campaign staff. So simply by inviting them via email here, they're able to go ahead and get contributions on behalf of that candidate. Of course, they have a little bit less sort of leeway in terms of the functionality they can see, so they can't go ahead and manipulate financials the same way. In the finance tab right here, a couple other functions, just in the same page, in order to send emails to yourself for backup documentation. So that's reports and PDFs that have information about all the contributions received, which become really important for backing up and making compliant contributions or submitting compliant contributions. And we also have other kind of helper files as well, which they can bring into everyday applications like Excel or Google Docs in order to sort and to see where some potential issues may come up. So we're actually just going to jump over kind of quickly to what that would look like, to one of the files that would be exported. And we just simply imported it into Google Docs. And so while not the most beautiful display ever, very useful and helpful so that the campaigns can do some of their own auditing far up in the process. Take, for example, column H, which lets them know if the donor is doing business in New York City so they can provide a little bit more scrutiny, or perhaps column O, which lets them know whether or not the credit card speed verification was passed or whether or not it wasn't checked by the bank. All this sort of specific detail, things that become very easy to search and sort and run reports on in order to make sure that way downstream there isn't all this work that needs to be done by the candidate, by some of the auditing organizations, just kind of get that stuff all exposed way up front. And that's sort of the arc of the candidate contribution tools. So we're able to process credit card contributions. We have compliance helpers along the way to get all the information saved away and captured for the contributor or from the contributor, and then means to get that information out and into other systems in the future. Some bulk upload features for something like C-Smart, for some reports that you can have to go ahead and run some manipulations on. And that's really it. We're just trying to make this as simple as possible, get it out there on mobile phones, get everyone to capture all the information that they need to, but only all the information that they need to, in a nice sort of shiny wrapper. And that's it.
Well, thank you. That was great.
You're welcome.
Just someone did one other thank you. A couple of people here from my team at Tipping Point Partners in my private life hat. And one of the reasons I want to say thank you to them is because all the time that I spend on doing this is time that I don't have to grow our business. And they're invested in this as well. And my children are back here. And time I spend on this is also time that I don't have with them. So I just want to say thanks to you guys. Now, one person on CFB that I haven't yet thanked is Anita Coward-Mayers, who is head of voter services. So you're going to come up and say something? Yeah. Well, you're going to close out, right? But I think Anita is very important because she'll close out the event. But she's really the face that touches, you know, what we think of as traditional organizing. And, you know, technology can't replace a human touch or human interaction, and people still need to see each other. So I think it's very important to remember that, and Anita has done some amazing work along with her team, and so I just want to say thanks there as well. So now we're going to go into a Q&A, and this is really an open opportunity for any candidate, any person here to come up and ask us questions about virtually anything, but questions that could relate to how would you use this, why would I use this, am I required to use it, you know, how do I get on, when can I start, how do I get off, you know. So I think we're going to have a team. So Michael, do you want to come back up? Dan Cho? Where's Dan? Okay. Yeah, Eric, are you going to come up? Mike, come up? We're all set, right? Okay, we need this. And maybe just to start, we'll just have everybody introduce themselves and the roles on the project. That way you get a sense for for the perspective that they're coming from. You don't have to answer any questions specifically to any particular person. I think we can decide among ourselves who's best equipped to answer. I also suggest that if you have any comments, please make them brief. This is really, time for Q&A. There's a mic up here. So if you can come up to the mic with questions, it would be very helpful if you could state your name and your role here, and we're asking a question. But let's just do some quick introductions.
I'm Michael Schubert, director at Pivotal Labs. I helped run a team that developed the application.
Hi, my name is Andy Chung. I'm a senior interaction designer at Method, and I helped with the interaction design.
Excuse me. I'm Eric Friedman. I'm director of external affairs at the Campaign Finance Board. I've really just been connecting the work that these guys have been doing with the work that our agency does, and hopefully that connection holds.
Good afternoon. My name is Dan Cho, and I'm the Director of Candidate Services with the New York City Campaign Finance Board. And it's great to see some familiar faces and a lot of candidates from our outreach.
Okay, well.
Good evening. Hi, I'm Eljoy Williams, and I am a rep for a number of candidates. And I just have three questions. Altogether, right now, candidates are required to have a merchant account if they use credit card processing. So does this tool now take that responsibility off the campaign? Two, is there any processing fee? Because we usually have to pay a processing fee for credit cards. And then lastly, the campaigner option where you can make a person a campaigner. If someone is holding a house party or if it's staff or something, we usually have to file on behalf of the campaign that a person collected donations for someone. Will that still apply as well?
Okay. I'll just start by making one small comment, which is that there is no requirement that a candidate use any of these features or services. This is completely optional. If the candidate views this as being beneficial to their campaign, then we'd be delighted if he used it. Do you want to try to address the Stripe issues?
Sure. So one of the primary goals that we worked through together and one of the kind of the primary hurdles that we all worked through together was setting up a merchant account is costly. It's technically frustrating. So one of our primary goals starting this off was to find a way to get those credit card contributions processed in a way that wasn't onerous for everyone. And what we identified was a technology called Stripe, which is a merchant services software company, which effectively serves or at least meets the requirements that a merchant account would fulfill. And I think Eric can correct me if I'm wrong. Sometimes I color outside of the lines and he has to let me know. But effectively, finding this technology was able to satisfy those requirements. And so in order to accept a credit card contribution, the candidate or the campaign simply needs to log into a Stripe account through this interface, which will let us perform transactions on their behalf with Stripe, but in a completely sort of walled off manner.
The fee?
Oh, the fee. They have sort of standard credit card fees, which are industry standard. Ish, I think it's somewhere around 2% or something. Like I don't remember specifically, but they weren't.
2.4.
Yep. Yeah, they weren't scary.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then the last question on the making someone a campaigner.
Can you wanna?
So I guess the function. Yeah. Well. So yeah. So the function itself, and this is actually one of the last things that we're ironing out. To be frank. Is do we restrict this specifically to campaign staff or do we sort of open this up? And I think there's a lot of debate and a lot of good debate about it, and it's one of the last items that we're really ironing out before we release this out to candidates. So the answer is a very interesting question, a very good question, a very poignant one, but I don't think we have an answer one way or the other just yet unless Eric tells me otherwise.
Okay.
I think you summed it up pretty well. I mean, there, you know, as they indicated, we're getting ready to roll this out, and there are a couple of those last questions that we want to make sure that we have good answers to. Like, the answers are, you know, the answers are our responsibility. They're not going to be, the idea is they're not going to be your responsibility. So we want to make sure that they're answered before we get it out in the wild for people to start raising money with.
To give some clarity, I think in this initial rollout, there may be an instance where we limit it to campaign staff, whether they be paid or volunteers, because what you can be sure of is the user, that campaigner, is authorized by the candidate. So we are talking and trying to finalize whether we can open it up to bundlers, house party supporters, and hosts.
Okay, thank you.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good afternoon. Thank you. This was a wonderful presentation. It seems like a phenomenal app, and I'm looking forward to using it. And on that note, my question, I work for Sean Gardner. He's running for City Council in District 8. My question is, when is it going to be available for use?
So as soon as we iron out these last couple issues, our target is you know, reasonably in about a week and a half. So we're working through in order to get it out as fast as possible, but we want to make sure that we're really delivering on that promise of this is as compliant as we can get it, and it's got all of the information that everyone really needs.
Thank you.
Yeah, and all the campaigns will receive an email.
Yes.
As soon as it's ready. And so we're targeting a week from Monday.
Thank
you. I have a couple questions. First, do you still have to provide backup documentations for donations made through the app? Two, you showed us going through the, as a candidate, you had to hand over your phone or your device to a person to make the donation. Are you planning on having the person sign in as a voter and able to make contributions to candidates?
So ultimately, when this is opened up to, you know, in the next phase for voters, yes, the idea is that voters can log in, find a candidate, find their polling place, and once they've found candidates, learned about them, make contributions directly to the candidate. But to the first part about backup documentation, yes, the backup documentation is still required for the contributions collected through this app. The idea is that it will produce a report that you can then take and give to CFB.
Would it also have a transaction ID already on it?
You'll have to, my understanding of it is that you'll fill in the transaction ID on your side.
I think the transaction ID should be on the report, right?
I don't know.
Well, we'll clarify that.
Right. I mean, this,
that's a good question. But I think that, because the issue is obviously we want to basically be able to tie together all the loose ends that make it difficult to show that a contribution complies with the rules.
Okay.
What we are working on, sorry to interrupt, what we are working on is the ability to import the contribution data, the data that you're collecting in person from the contributor to in a sweep fashion and an import fashion from the application through its export reports straight into C-Smart, our campaign finance disclosure program. So with everything and technology, it's one step at a time. We haven't been able to eliminate backup documentation altogether, but at least we're attempting to figure out ways to prevent the duplication of possible data entry.
And one last thing, I think the company is Striker, you said, the finance?
Strike. Right.
Strike. Is there a setup fee for that?
There's not.
Roland Jimenez, two questions. The first one is, will voters be able to see or get a link on a candidate's website for this? And my second question is, when do you foresee we'll be voting on this app?
Well, so the first question, it's entirely up to each candidate if they would like to link to it from their website, and certainly that is something that's easy enough to do, and we can provide a way to do that. As for voting, I'm not sure we're ready to discuss the issues around online voting here today, but it's not coming next week.
And a lot of this is going to depend upon...
Next
All right. On the first one, actually, a lot depends upon the, I think, the technical abilities of your team. We're going to try to do as much as we can to make it as easy as possible to embed the contribution image on, so you can embed it on your web page. But, you know, again, we don't know if we're going to get all the way there by the time that you need it.
And so I think to add on to that is what, you know, which was alluded to earlier, is the goal is to take this from candidates and campaign staff and bring it outwards to voters, but and to kind of balloon the features and functionality of it so that it's all-encompassing. And to that end, we don't have all the answers. So as we're building this, candidates, users, if there are people who have feedback and questions, these questions are great questions, engage. We would love to help. You know, if a number of people consider, you know, XYZ is the next roadblock to us achieving you know, a simpler experience, let us know, and you know, if we're not already trying to go there, we'll try to go there.
Nan Beer, I'm a campaign treasurer. I have one brief comment and also a few questions, and I'd like to just dispose of the comment first. I noticed as in your sample, the contributor is going through the electronic equivalent of the contribution form, and for the employment information, asks the employer, and then it says address. And CFB currently facilitates letters and emails with the same sort of thing. In a number of cases, I get back stuff where the contributor has put his residential address. And I think it would be helpful if it said business address, just as you also say residential address in the section that pertains to residents.
Thank you.
That said, our campaign uses a third party to staff fundraisers. Would they currently be able to... Yeah, we have a contract with an outfit. That's one of their duties. Would they be able, in the first rollout, would they be able to use this application, or is everyone going to use the candidate's login? How would that work?
I think the key would go back to whom the candidate would like to designate as a campaigner in this first rollout. So I think you're specifically talking about either a fundraising agent or a fundraising firm that the campaign may have hired. So it would be up to the campaign, but in order to finalize discussions on what was alluded by Eljoy Williams was the intermediary requirement. So we want to ensure if someone's a fundraiser paid by the campaign or considered a fundraising agent, that that issue doesn't come up.
Best of my understanding, they're not a fundraising agent, but one of their duties is to be there at fundraisers and, you know, assist the campaign in any way that they can. So frequently they're working the door at an event.
In that instance, they could be considered a fundraising agent because they're paid by the campaign to fundraise. But we can take that into consideration determining opening this up to additional users separate from staff.
Okay. A number of Democratic campaigns, including the one that I'm involved in, are using the NGP database. Currently, if you have a merchant account, your information is downloaded directly into NGP. Not into C-Smart, of course, but into NGP. Is there going to be any facility for importing credit card contributions through this tool for downloading to something other than C-Smart? Is there some way that we would be able to export stuff and then so we can import it into something besides C-Smart?
From a technical standpoint.
You have a mic already.
I turned it off. Oh. Well, I guess. From a technical standpoint, not at all. I think we'd have to iron out some of the policy, but I think it would be straightforward.
But I mean, would it have that facility at initial rollout or just something that you think about down the road?
From what we saw this afternoon, there's already export to Excel or a CSV file, which will be compatible to CSmart. And we are, as an agency, exploring ways to import other databases into CSmart using a uniform CSV format that this application is also using. So we did see an export into Google Drive, which was just an Excel spreadsheet.
Okay. With the import into CSmart, the old CSmart, you know, when it was locally on our own computers, not on the web, had an import function, which I actually tried once. And pretty much, you know, it was trying to match the name, which, of course, is what you want to do. But if there was anything that was not a perfect match, you basically went through every field in the name record. And you had to indicate, you know, this is the one I want, not this one, you know, from the name that was coming from the import and the name that was already in the system. Are we going to see something similar when stuff is being imported into CSmart? Or would we wind up with multiple names if it doesn't see a match?
We're currently working on that, whether it be importing into CSmart from another database or from Stripe. So we're finalizing. You're basically getting to the how to dedupe names, whether it's on the front end upon import or on the back end once you import it, to have CSmart tell you these are possible matches and how to clean it up. So we're working on it.
Yeah, we've done a little, you know, dupe cleanup in our campaign already. I'm sure a lot of people have. What I would love to see in CSmart is a merge function where you say these two names are the same, merge all their data, because currently you delete all the data, you delete the name record, you re-enter all the data on the other side. It's a very awkward process, and there's always the possibility that you will re-enter something incorrectly, which is not helpful. Of course, and also the transaction ID reference changes when you do that. So it's kind of a bad deal all around. And one last question. With Stripe, so there are fees, and would we find out when we sign up for an account what those fees actually are so we can compare it to, you know, what we're getting bled for currently?
Yeah, you could check it out right now. Stripe.com, the company is called Stripe Payments, and all of their fees are listed directly on the website.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Those are great questions, by the way. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you. It seemed very simple. I'm not technology savvy, but it seemed very, very simple. I appreciate that. But one of the things I'm my concern when you're doing paper document, when something missing, for me, I'm very old fashioned. I like to reach to people, talk to people, and know who my contributors are since I'm running locally. But with the app, if you don't complete the field, all the fields required, it will not get let you proceed and submit. That's right. Great. That's one thing, because I don't like looking all over, trailing people to get paper or correction, whatever. And another thing, people out of state. For me, I'm very concerned about contributors all over. If that app, how we can, I don't know, how you're going to track down maybe people that are giving, like, for example, we're talking about technology from out of state, from wherever they may be. Is that a way we can track that down? You can prevent from your app that people contributing that you don't want to contribute to you?
Yeah, so in the file that we walked through at the end, it has all of the information from the contributions.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're savvy with Excel or there's someone on your team, could very easily bring this in and sort on the state field and know exactly who it is that's out of state so that you can go target those contributions.
Thank you. Thank you, Dan.
Hi, I have two questions. One, is this app currently or in the future going to be able to take like a mobile swipe payment?
I'm working on it.
Okay. All right. And then the second question.
One of the things, I'll just say this, because I, you know, my job is to be the optimist. and this said to basically get everyone to try to reach for that goal, and the swipe technology is one of the key elements. We're working on what the specific implementation is, and how to make it work, and we have some solutions that we're looking at, and I'm very optimistic that we'll bring it to life. But again, candidates will find out via email from the CFB.
Okay. And then the second question is, say there's something, the contribution would go through, but there's something wrong with the backup documentation eventually when we would get to a match. Would that prevent the initial contribution from going through, or is it going to be the same sort of thing where we'll get something back in a statement review saying, okay, now you need to go get X, Y, and Z from the contributor?
Can you state your question again?
So there's certain, as an example, say AVS verification fails on the contribution, would it still be able to go through even though it's not even though eventually you'd get something back in the statement review? Would the initial contribution then go through and then sort of the same process that we have now? Or does this prevent contributions from going through that aren't completely match compliant?
Yeah, the goal is that we're only providing you with fields that are absolutely required, and so we run checks.
But let's say the check fails for a variety of reasons. Does that mean, like, say the AVS check fails, does that mean we're not going to be able to accept the contribution, or does that mean that we'll accept the contribution but it won't be eligible for match until we get confirmation?
So it's immediate. So if that AVS fails,
right,
you'll know right away.
Right, but then
contributor.
Will we still get the money from that contribution, or is it, do we have to, or is it later on, do we?
I mean, I think part of the idea is it allows the contributor to fix the issue.
Right there.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So basically, in order to get the contribution to go through, it's going to need to be 100% compliant for a match. Besides for the fact that they live out of state or whatever, if they're a New York City resident and they're compliant for match, that it'll go through. It'll only go through once they're eligible for a match. Is that what I'm sort of on?
Sure. Yeah.
Sorry.
The goal is to have the contributions. You will have very little problems on the end, so that either we'll reject the contribution completely if you don't have the full information that's required. Obviously, you can't guarantee that 100%, but the goal is to try and minimize so that the back and forth that you'll have with us, that if you use this, most of the contributions that go through that you get the money for have already met the backup documentations.
Great. Thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Bonnie. I'm actually live tweeting this demonstration, and we got a question from a follower. So the question is, how is this app secured? What prevents payment information from being revealed to the next user? And specifically, he's talking about before this app is revealed to the wider public.
Sure. So it's using pretty standard, HTTPS, a lot of things that secure, any online shopping that you would do. Stripe in particular is probably more excellent than most online payment providers in terms of the way they work. They intercept the credit card information as it's being typed in and gets sent directly to them, so it never actually goes into the application at all. So it's in many ways, technically under the hood, it's probably even more secure than most sites that you shop on that don't use Stripe or something equivalent. Does that answer your question?
I hope the user.
Good evening. My name is Brody Enoch. I'm running for City Council District 7. My goal is, except for cash, to have a totally paperless campaign. That's my goal, to get rid of contribution cards and everything. I want 1,000 of them, but is there any in the future, do you see, because I can see this actually being used even for checks. I know when we get checks, we can take pictures of the check and have that deposited right into our account. Is there any plan to be able to do that with this app? Take the picture and still fill out the same information instead of a contribution card? And do you see in the future, because like I said, I really hate, I love contribution cards, don't get me wrong. There's just so many of them, it's less a lot of paper. Do you see in the future, instead of using contribution cards, just using some form of this app or using this app to replace contribution cards, and having that go directly to C-Smarter, even if we have to use contribution cards, possibly doing it the same way that you can take a picture of a check. Take a picture of your contribution card, the information is immediately uploaded into C-Smart, and you just keep the hard copy for your files.
I think the answer is all those things are possible. Mm-hmm. I think for this particular project, we had to narrow the scope to something that we could actually build. But those are all great ideas. They're fantastic. They're used by other services, and we'll definitely keep note of them. And as you go through your campaign, you'd love to hear what your specific experience is.
All right, thank you. Remember where that came from, by the way. Just.
Good evening, Ruben Dario Vargas. I have a concern. When the contribution is made, and provided that the individual making a contribution comply with every requirement, and the contribution is submitted, could we reject the contribution in the system, or are we allowed to whether approve or reject the contribution, or the contribution will go directly into the bank account or the system?
Dan, you want to take this?
Yeah. I mean, as a right, you have the right to refund a contribution, whether there be an issue with it and it was cited, or you already preemptively found out that you need to refund. So through Stripe or through this application, there should be an ability on the back end to refund, but I'm not so sure on the incoming aspect of the funds that you can just stop it before it's received.
That is actually my question. Can we stop that contribution, whether it cannot be stopped? If an unwanted person, like, for example, that perhaps has a criminal record or whatsoever, and that person, and we're not interested in that contribution, do we have to go through the whole process and then having to send a contribution back, or just stop that from coming into me?
One thing to keep in mind, and this is for the whole group, in this first rollout, the campaign, you as a candidate are going to have all the controls over who you're walking up to and having them fill out all their contribution information. So we will address as far as refunds are concerned, but in your initial concerns, as you get comfortable with using this application, it's going to be the campaign that approaches individuals to receive their contributions. So at that point, you may or may not know you want to accept the contribution, because you might not have that additional information about the contributor that later on you find out and you want to issue a refund.
Thank you. I have a second question. In the demonstration, I didn't see referring to doing business with the city. If the contributor is doing business with the city, it only was the statement, the legal statement, but it doesn't indicate about doing business with the city. That I don't remember.
On the second page with the employment information, there's the doing business legal information, and the user must indicate yes or no whether or not they're doing business.
Thank
and
you.
There's a link on that page that will open up a window with the full description of all the different sorts of business that are covered by the law and so on, and the different roles.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And Alan will navigate to that page just so you can refresh and take a look at it. Okay, great.
I just want to make sure I understood, as a campaign, you designate a person as a campaigner to actually take the contribution. Is it a universal ID, or each campaigner has a unique ID so you can track, and that's assigned to that particular contribution so you can follow it as an audit trail through the whole system?
One of the small details that we're still working out, and it's from a technical perspective. Once we really have a very firm vision of it, it'll be very clear and straightforward for us to implement, and we will make sure that the answer to that question.
And I just want to make sure I asked the right question. Can you tell me what I asked? Just to make sure I asked the right question. So I want to make sure I understand.
That may be the best question.
I'm concerned that there's an audit trail for right. that person that who has been designated by the campaign. So if I go back later, I can say all of the contributions that came from this particular person that designated campaigner,
yes.
I can find that to, I'll be able to find that person. Okay, this one
yes.
makes sure I was clear.
Yes, so if Steve is taking bad contributions for you, yeah. you should be able to know, you should be able to find Steve.
I don't want to be that explicit.
Does this tool collect email addresses and phone numbers of the contributors?
Yes.
Yes.
I have two questions as chair of governmental operations. One is, how does the Board of Elections, if at all, play any role? And second, as you know, we have a bill to do texting of campaign contributions. And I just don't like the other person who was so articulate about how great this is and your next step. I didn't know if texting would be part of it. Those are my two. And congratulations.
Thank you, Councilwoman. So, the first question had to do with the Board of Elections. And the second, I think your views are well known on the board. So this piece of it, the first phase is rolled out specifically for candidates, contributors, and their interaction with the Campaign Finance Board staff. And as such, the Board of Elections doesn't really play a piece in this. The overall project, however, has a direct connection to some of the activities of the board, and we have been in a very active conversation with them about bringing some of these business processes to bear on the processes used by the Board of Elections, and we've invited them to be a partner in this technology. So your help would be very, very valuable. On the second aspect, which has to do with text to vote or text to contribute, as someone with a reasonably long experience on text to donate, buy, contribute, the challenge here really has to do with the fees charged by the wireless carriers, which are way outside of our jurisdiction. For most commercial uses, the typical fee charged by a wireless carrier is 50% of the transaction amount. There are exceptions that they've made for things like Sandy Relief or Red Cross and others, but those have been on a one-by-one, ad hoc basis. So I think if there were to be kind of a wider interest in use of text to donate or text to contribute, we would love to see the wireless carriers, I think, reduce their charges for this.
Thank you.
But technically, it's possible. Are there any other questions? Okay,
the name is Greg Mays. So are you basically saying that people don't need merchant accounts if they want to process credit cards at this point? Because I heard you suggest that you could actually use this app or some version of it on your website.
Yes. You do not need to have a separate merchant account.
Okay, in order to process credit card.
You will have to register with Stripe.
Right.
And Stripe will establish an account which is the equivalent of a merchant account for you.
Okay. So that requirement is only if you're using this optional application, which right. we encourage. You could conceivably just sort of have a button on your website that takes you to the page to enter this data and stuff.
Yes.
Okay. So that's a major selling point that you might just want to communicate, because I'm not sure if you know or not. Merchant accounts, thank God I got one. They don't, come real, real easy. The next question is, there's no signature capture anywhere.
There's the affirmation statement and then the checkbox, which prior to proceeding, just like it would be on.
All right. Thank you.
Perfect. Are there any other questions? 3, 2, 1. Oh, yes. Okay.
My experience is that they prefer an individual record,
So are you saying to us that that report, that Excel report, would serve as that individual, as the record that we would send if we put the individual numbers against each line? Or do we have to break it out?
I mean, I would say that that's probably on the short list of things that are going to be addressed before this is introduced. And I mean, the actual report that we'll take is going to look a little different. But that'll be something we'll, you know, tightening those last few bolts, and it'll be ready soon.
So what would it look like? Would it be the individual report, or would it be the spreadsheet?
So my understanding is, if for the backup documentation, that we have to provide a single sheet per transaction, and so as one of the exports, we will provide that PDF to you. In addition, this sort of unofficial export is intended for you to use to help identify potential concerns, such as out-of-state transactions or those sorts of things, so that you can manipulate the transactions that come in through here or the contributions that come in through this system, just for your internal purposes, for internal auditing, and to help you.
Okay, but you just said PDF. PDF is not usually editable?
Yes.
So how do I get my number on it?
Two separate reports, right? One, so one's the PDF that you bring into CFB. One is just a CFB file that you can use in Excel for yourself.
Is that because of policy reasons, legal reasons, that you have to do it this way, which is clearly not the easiest way to do it for the documentation trail? I mean, is this a law that can be changed to reflect the technology that you have now?
I wouldn't say it's a law. It's something that makes the work of the audit team easier.
Well, when we explain a lot of the matching claims requirements to candidates, there's data, so maybe this might help clear up, Joan, what you were asking. There's data, and then there's documentation to substantiate the information that we're receiving via C-Smart, the data. So in this first rollout, it is a report, which is going to be the documentation, which we do accept electronically. That you can save as a PDF once the data is imported into C-Smart and you actually have transaction IDs.
Yeah, I mean, the main reason to treat the thing is because this is not, you'll have to upload it into C-Smart, and then you'll have the transaction IDs that they have to append it to the data, and then the contributions have to be matched to a contribution that's in C-Smart so that they can be audited.
I had a question. I think you said earlier that the PDF will already have the transaction ID. Is that true or false?
It can't, because this is not in C-Smart yet. You have to upload it into C-Smart and then get the transaction ID.
Is there a way that we could figure out after you upload it, then you can create a PDF with the transaction ID? Because that would be the biggest thing for the paper trail.
We can look into that.
You know, you're a fountain of great ideas.
Was there enough for David indicating that the information is correct?
Mr. Vargas, go ahead. Another question here from Mr. Vargas.
I just missed it. If is there an affidavit into this indicating the contributor affirming that the information provided are correct?
Yes, that was the affirmation statement with the checkbox before proceeding with the final contribution.
Perfect. Any more questions? Okay, over here.
Hello. We met before. My name is Abby Laurel Smith. About the payment portal, I was just thinking, is it possible to link it through the email? Which means if someone pays, you have two options, email or phone notification. That way, one goes to the email, one goes to C-Smart, and you can open it either way. Also, you have an option of CSV, so you can't really rule either of those out.
I'm sorry, you mean notification to the candidate when a contribution comes in?
Yes, if someone pays at the end, there will be two notifications. One will be via email, when we go to the campaign committee's email, they can open that. And then there will be the CSV option, which gives the broad view that you have on here. That might be the easiest way to do it. So that way you can actually print out each payment and then you can cross-check on whatever you have. I was just working on a portal until last week when I got this. I was developing it for myself, yes. But I had to give it up to see this. So.
That's terrific.
Yeah. Yeah,
thank you for that suggestion. Very, very good.
And I would say on this first phase when it's... for the most part, it's going to be candidates who are sort of collecting the contributions.
Okay.
That's probably less important. But once this is sort of expanded to voters who just make contributions to anybody, that's something to consider.
I'm not checking my email. I'm writing. Someone else did it earlier, just the idea.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else? Going once? Going twice? Okay, well, Anita, would you like to come up and do some final words? And may have a big round of applause for our panelists.
Hello, everyone. Well, you know, I have a role, a very special role today, and I'm going to ask you to join me in thanking our chair, Art Chang. We can do better than that, right? I tell you, thank you. Thank you very much. When Art came, Art was a board member of the Campaign Finance Board, and about 2 years ago, there was a charter mandate that all of you might have voted in, I hope, and that was how to best utilize the city's resources to make the most of voter participation and voter engagement in New York City. When they did that, we also then got Mr. Art Chang as the chairman of the Voter Assistance Advisory Committee. And one of the first things we heard from Art was really, we need to take a new look at things. Things just should not be the same. And it shouldn't be what we think. It should be what people out there are thinking. How do we want to interface with our voting experience? What do other people want it to look like and feel like? And he began to assemble a very intelligent, brilliant, dedicated, committed group of people who started to think about that. And this is the first phase of what we're seeing. So again, I really want to thank him for this. This is the role where you come in. Why is all of this important? Yes, we've been talking about the very technical aspects of it, but to go back to the first goal, which is NYC Votes is on a mission to transform voting for 4.3 million registered New York City voters by Election Day 23. And in order to do that, we need you. Why is that important? Because about 2 years ago, New York State was number 47 in voter participation around the whole country. That's not a place that we're comfortable with. That's not a place we believe where we should be. We are very vocal New Yorkers. We are the first at everything in New York. So no reason why we are going to be the first to make sure we can transform and revitalize the voting experience for New Yorkers. Are you ready to help us with that? Okay, because we need it. We believe that candidates are the key, that you hold the key to voters. We believe that you'll be able to help them. There are a couple of different dynamics here. One, there are those people who just really, truly need voter education. They don't know what their rights are. They don't know what they're supposed to do. They just don't know. There are other people who are completely engaged, but maybe need just reminders. So a lot of times, people are engaged, they're registered, they know where to go, they know who's there, but they need reminders. We live busy lives. We are New Yorkers. We want to, and that's where the role of the Campaign Finance Board also comes in, because we help to advocate for things. We want to make your life easier. This is the reason why we're starting this and other types of things. But we're looking for candidates to help us as well. And it's a two-way street. We're hoping this tool is going to help you, but because you are our future leaders, and we need our population base to know they can trust our leaders, that the systems they are using are trustworthy, and that you will be out there as our main ambassadors, registering people, letting them know the importance of voting, letting them know that they can count on their New York City and New York State legislators. So, is everyone ready to sign up? Okay, we're going to give a countdown, and everyone's going to start to sign up. I want you to also know that you can look out for other tools this year. We have the printed voter guide that's going to come to everyone's home. And we're also going to have the video voter guide, which allows each candidate to come in and to record video statements. And that will be aired as well. So look out, and Candidate Service Unit will be the conduit for all of this. So once again, I'd like to thank everyone, and I'd like to thank our chair. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. We'll be here for a few minutes if you want to come up and ask any questions.